Good evening and very warm welcome to a special, special evening. This is to commemorate the 100th birth anniversary of a great man, Prime Minister, former Prime Minister I.K. Gujral. The man who started really as an Aam Aadmi and then ended up as Prime Minister, but always remained an Aam Aadmi. He in fact started life as a communist, as Sitaram Yechuri, not Kesri, would love to hear and of course knows about it. He was foreign minister twice, and as a prime minister he was the most humble man. We've done a lot of research, talked to a lot of people who knew him. He was an absolute intellectual and perhaps most of all a real firm believer in the constitution. And just one little anecdote. All the years since independence, right up to when he became Prime Minister, every morning the IB chief would present a report first thing in the morning to the Prime Minister, and you know, obviously try and upset the apple cart in many ways. When Mr. Gujral became Prime Minister, he said, "I don't want any of these reports anymore." He told his principal secretary, "You look at it. If there's anything really important, you show it to me." He was determined to keep all these institutions independent, as well as the judiciary completely independent. And probably they were at the peak of independence during his tenure. He was known as a gentleman prime minister. That's a very common phrase used about him. But he was much more than that. I think the best way to describe Mr. Gujral was a man who was trusted. And trusted not just by his own party, by opposition, but he was trusted by leaders of neighboring countries as well. We've spoken to many of them, and it was a period when perhaps our relationships between leaders in the South Asian region were at the finest. He was a man they really trusted. But he was also a man who had great personal relationships, which are very important in foreign policy, as everybody will know. For example, the United States was very, very insistent that India sign the CTBT. But really, it was his trust and his personal relationship with President Clinton when he went there. And he convinced and just stuck to his position, and President Clinton said, "Okay, you were lucky because the architect of the nuclear deal is sitting right here. It wouldn't have happened if he had signed at that time." And I think it was also a period when media was at its finest and most independent. We were there and we were allowed to do anything, even on Doordarshan. And in fact, what exemplifies how great he was, if you ask me, is that during the emergency, when the emergency was declared, he was IND minister. But even as IND minister, he could not take the emergency. And he said, "I will not accept it." And he told Sanjay Gandhi that. And he was removed. And then he became in the planning commission and then went to Soviet Union as an ambassador. So he stuck to his guns in the face of tremendous party pressure. A man of great principles. Now I have three people from the greatest three foreign service secretaries that you will ever come across, and there's one more here actually. Yes, absolutely, in the same category. So you can ask them tough questions when they don't answer properly, right? Kamal Sibal, Shyam Saran, Shiv Shankar Menon. Thank you all. You all knew him well. And one of the things he's commonly known for, is the Gujral Doctrine. He never used that term himself. Others used it about him, but it was his. And that's again another indication of the modesty and the humility of the man. How relevant, Shiv Shankar Menon, is that today?
Properly defined? Very relevant.
Still today?
Still, because I think people confuse the doctrine. It wasn't meant to apply to Pakistan or to China. as I think was mentioned already earlier in the evening. But for the other neighbors, there's no question that we need to build a relationship where, as the foreign minister just reminded us, where our concerns are met, but equally that they have an interest in keeping the relationship with India growing, and it's that we actually build on what we already have, the affinities which we have. And that's something which the Gujral doctrine recognized by saying no reciprocity with our other neighbors.
I mean, you deal with these smaller countries, but you don't ask for anything in return, no reciprocity.
You ask for things in return, but you don't ask for exactly the same thing back, because
right.
We are the bigger country.
Right.
You know, Mr. Gujral sent me to Sri Lanka as High Commissioner. And one of the earliest things he did was to tell me, see if we can do a free trade agreement to Sri Lanka. And this was before we did all the other free trade agreements. And don't forget, this is a government which is quite shaky. I mean,
he had a lot of political pressure, it was unstable, and he was thinking of...
And yet he
kept
was
his focus.
Of big strategic things. I mean, here you are being... We just heard about Faraka, the FTA with Sri Lanka, which transformed the relationship. There a whole series of things which really mattered for the future. But he was careful. He also said, please make and talk to Mr. Vajpayee. Make sure that you talk to all of them and then do this process of negotiating, which we did. And we completed it actually in Mr. Vajpayee's time. But he set these things in motion. And so for me, actually, his approach to the neighborhood is fundamentally sound, because it recognizes the imbalance, the asymmetries in size and power, and the fact that our prosperity and security depends on what happens in our immediate neighborhood.
Right. But Shyam Saran, didn't it start with the inclusion of Pakistan as well? No reciprocity, the same five principles, but then things began to deteriorate and then it got adjusted, no Pakistan or China.
Well, let me put it this way. I think it is true that the principles that are associated with the so-called Gujral doctrine did apply to countries other than Pakistan. But I think he did not have any doubt that a more normal relationship with Pakistan was also necessary in terms of India being able to play a larger regional role, a larger global role. That this relationship was important and had to be fixed. So in terms of, you know, making certain that there is a dialogue process with Pakistan, I think the, you know, composite dialogue, for example, even though, therefore, that the doctrine in the sense of non-reciprocity did not apply to Pakistan, but that is not to say that he did not think that in terms of the larger neighborhood policy, having a more normal relationship with Pakistan was also essential.
Thomas, I mean, we are now, in hindsight, it's easy to look back and say things could have been done a little differently. But over these years, under that doctrine, under reciprocity, but is it true that today China is much more influential in all these neighboring countries than it was at the time of Mr. Gujral?
Well, that is very true, because China has progressed immensely, especially in the last 20 years or so. They've become the second largest economic power in the world, the biggest exporter in the world. They have $3 trillion of foreign exchange reserves. They have this humongous Belt and Road initiative, and they are willing to give a lot of money to
which
our neighbors.
Even Bangladesh is supporting.
Bangladesh supports, Sri Lanka supports, Nepal
everybody,
supports.
All our neighbors.
And in fact, their leaders have been attending the Belt and Road forums in Beijing. In fact, China has become the largest aid donor to Nepal, the biggest investor in Sri Lanka. They have defense relationship with Bangladesh. All their defense equipment comes from China. So yes, China is fully exploiting its financial muscle and its capacity to invest and to take very quick decisions and implement them, and displacing us from our previous position
with these
in
neighbors.
Our neighborhood.
Yeah.
And I think our approach should be that we should not compete one-on-one with China, because we don't have the same resources. We have other assets which China does not have. We are not seeking a kind of a colonial overlordship over these countries. We are far more consultative when it comes to aid programs.
But doesn't China start very slowly, and it's a much longer term view of...
They have really started colonial. Look at what has happened in Sri Lanka, where they got a 99-year lease on Hambantota, reminding us of the British 99-year lease of Hong Kong. And the international repercussions of this. So many countries have now started looking very carefully whether they are walking into a debt trap insofar as China is concerned. So it's not as if China's policies are very successful or they're being viewed, especially today, as simply benign with no afterthoughts about creating political constituencies. And their earlier policy of not interfering in the internal affairs of countries is no longer there. They have manipulated the elections in Nepal by bringing the two communist parties together. And I don't know.
This is an unfair question to ask three foreign service kings. But with China doing so well in our immediate neighborhood, has our foreign policy failed?
I don't think so, not at all. The question is, how do you respond to it?
Yes.
When things change around you, when circumstances change, you have to change what you do.
You have to
up your game. I think we've done it partly. I'm not sure we've done enough. I'm sure each one of us will have a list of things that we think we should be doing.
Well, there's two things we should have done.
Well, three things, I think, if you want, actually. I think you should be much more active in maritime security in the Indian Ocean. Working with your smaller neighbors, whether it's in the Bay of Bengal. Now, we've been trying this for several years. From about 2008-09, we started with. But we should be doing much more there. And we can do much more, because we have the ability, and there's demand for it as well.
And the Chinese are walking in where we are not doing it.
Secondly, I think you have to make sure that, you see, the neighbors will naturally look for balancers to you, but they also want balancers to China.
Yes.
So you don't need to get into, as Kamal said, into man-to-man marking, into one-on-one sort of direct competition. But there are other things you can do with your other neighbors, which you have other advantages, whether it's in various forms of soft power in terms of access. You have to make yourself useful to them. Today, for instance, Colombo Port, unlike Hambantota Port, 83% of what goes through that port is to or from India. That port needs you as much as you need it.
Right.
The more you can build those kinds of relationships where there's a mutual interest in it, you can do much more.
Build mutual
relationships. And I think you should be, we should be doing that. Frankly, we need to be much more sensible in our border regions. We should treat the borders as zones where we interact, rather than building walls, fences, trying to say we're going to throw people out, or starting to export our domestic political confusions into our relationships, say with Bangladesh, with Myanmar, with our neighbors. And that's something that I think we really need to show some discipline in. But that's a much harder call.
Export,
we shouldn't take party politics into our relationships with our neighbors.
In fact, Shyam Saran, when you were ambassador in Mauritius and I.K. Gujral was prime minister, you had the IORA, the Indian Ocean Rim, what was it called? Indian Ocean Rim Association, which are the smaller countries.
In 1995, it came up as the Indian Ocean Rim Initiative.
Initiative, yes.
And
then it became...
This was something which, though of course we had an active role in promoting this concept, but it was actually Mauritius which held the first meeting.
Right.
And originally we had seven countries who were part and parcel of that. And there was a bit of a drama
about
that.
And this Pakistan was kept out.
Beg your pardon?
IORA Pakistan was kept out right from the start.
Yes. In fact, there was a bit of a drama because the Mauritians, under the influence of Australia and a couple of other countries, did in fact extend an invitation to Pakistan. And it was a rather difficult job to get the Mauritians to take the invitation back.
But you've done a lot of difficult jobs, right?
But
you just said, why do you want every IORA meeting to turn into a Indo-Pak discussion, right?
What is important is that, there was some controversy here in India in the Ministry of External Affairs whether it was a good thing to have kept Pakistan out. And I was summoned to Mr. Gujral's office to explain.
To Mr. Gujral's office. Yeah.
And his first reaction was, why should we say no to Pakistan? So then I explained to him why I had...
So first you convinced the Mauritians, then you convinced him as well.
And I must say that he, you know, and this is the quality of Mr. that he was very consultative, he was very open to listening to other opinions, would not have a rigid view about anything. So he heard me out and he said, good, I'm glad you did that. So this was something which later on, you know, grew into the Indian Ocean Rim Association, and it was formally established in 1997.
Shashankar Menon says we haven't really participated enough.
Maritime security, I think that continues to be an issue, because you know, if we say that we are a maritime power, I think to have only 15 or 16% of our defense budget devoted to the Navy, I think does not reflect that importance of the Navy. And I think especially with regard to the, you know, Sri Lanka or the Maldives, or even further, you know, Mauritius. Sessions itself. I think quite a bit of initiative has been taken. I think Jaishankar himself has taken some initiative.
But is this a worry for you? These rim, we always talk about the main countries very near us, but these rim islands where the Chinese are having a major influence. Do you think we should have played more?
Not really. Let's not exaggerate that. Well, you've seen what happened in Sri Lanka, and I was quite surprised that Gotabaya is now openly saying he's going to ask for a revision of the Hanbantota 99-year lease. It's bold of him to say that. Let's see if he can implement it. And the Chinese are worried because they are already issued a statement. It's a win-win agreement and stuff like that. Our relations with Bangladesh are excellent. They've never been as good as they are today, despite what the Chinese penetration in that country is. Nepal is a bit of a problem, but we continue to make efforts with Nepal. And with Maldives, we've seen a reversal of fortunes. We've got a government now which is pro-Indian, if you like, in inverted commas, from one that was very visibly and aggressively pro-Chinese. And we've made inroads into Seychelles. In Mauritius, we are working with them in the Aga Lega Islands to develop a port, a base for ourselves.
Bangladesh and Shivshankar Menon's point of view that we should not export our internal problems to our neighbors.
Look, this problem about illegal immigrants, Mr. Vajpayee, when I was Foreign Secretary, we in fact gave them figures. Home Minister Advani was very, open about this with the Bangladeshis, and in fact we raised this issue, as well as of course the question of they giving safe havens to Ulfa insurgents and everything else. But the Bangladeshis were absolutely refusing to accept to India, and in fact they reversed the argument to say that we have a lot of illegal Indians who are coming and working clandestinely in Bangladesh. We were not getting anywhere with the Zia government. So it's a long-standing issue. It has not been conjured up today out of the blue. We have dealing with it much more robustly.
Are we becoming robust is a word, more stridently dealing with it now?
Well,
which is a little bit,
but I think it's
less inclusive. And
well, I don't know, one can have different views, but I can't see why we cannot have a national register of citizens. After all, if we are, all these big countries have identity cards. I mean, Europeans have them, Americans have them, everything else. So why is it in India we don't want to have identity cards? Why not? The question is not that. The question is not identity. No, let me just complete this. The question is not one of identifying. The question is what you do after you've identified non-citizens or people who've come in clandestinely. That is the political issue. For the rest, I think we should go in and have it.
So what should you do?
Have the National Register of Citizens.
When you find them.
Then you deal with the problem as it is. I don't think you can send them out.
You can't
force Bangladesh to accept them because they start challenging everything. And with Nepal, in any case, we have a free border. There are about 6-8 million Nepalese working here. This does not apply to them. And so actually it is very limited to the demographic changes that have occurred in our border states and elsewhere in India because of the influx of illegal immigrants from Bangladesh. But Bangladesh government, I am quite surprised, they are pretty much at ease. They have not raised this issue. They keep saying that this is an internal matter. We've been assured this will remain an internal matter. So I don't think we should unnecessarily raise fears.
Are you just raising fears, Shankarman?
No, I think there's a different problem we're talking about. We're not talking about should there be an NRC or not is an Indian issue, which we decide ourselves. We can have different opinions on that. With Bangladesh today, Bangladesh behaves very differently from the way it behaved during Mr. Vajpayee's time. Bangladesh has cracked down on Indian insurgent groups, cooperates with us, and actually contributes positively to our security in a way that she never used to in the past. Secondly, as you mentioned, China is much more active in Bangladesh. But you have now built various links, whether it's inland water transport, whether it's a supply of electricity. There's a whole series of links you've built over the last decade with Bangladesh, which is why we agree that today's relations are better than ever before. But if you start calling infiltrators or immigrants or whatever you want to call them, termites, if you say I'm going to expel them and push them across the border, if you take on issues that really matter to Bangladesh, like Rohingyas, if you take very negative attitudes and base those on communal responses, saying they're terrorists, who are you to convict them as terrorists? And officially, to make state, then you're running a risk with a relationship which really matters. That's my point. Don't export whatever arguments you might have at home about an NCR, about National Register of Citizens, about all these things. That's your business. But don't export it to your neighborhood.
Thanks for foreign policy and foreign relations. Shyam Saran?
Well, I agree with what Shankar is saying, that, foreign policy is complicated enough.
Yeah.
Domestic politics starts affecting your foreign relations, then life can become very difficult. I think in this context, it is not just what policy you are adopting, but I think it is also very important in the manner in which you articulate it. Perhaps it is important to have an NRC, but the kind of packaging that you are giving it, the language that you are using, may have negative consequences.
So just going back to Mr. Gujral, how would he have handled this situation?
Well, I think
one thing I just want to, sorry, before you say that, he called you and said, why haven't you included? So he accepted criticism?
Yes. I mean, at least on that particular occasion, he certainly did. So,
and you convinced him?
I think more than whether he agreed or disagreed, I think what is very important is that he was extraordinarily consultative. He was not only open to different points of view, but actively sought different points of view. I think that is very important.
That's a huge,
and it did not matter
hugely
where,
important factor for a leader.
It did not matter where that view was coming from. When he was, for example, foreign minister, I used to sit in a corner room near the gate number four, is it?
Oh. Yeah.
And I would be known as the doorkeeper. Because it was the room which was the first room that you encountered before you went inside the
doorkeeper for India.
But he, as foreign minister, sometimes he would just open the door and come in and he said, what about this?
Really?
What is your view on this? Or give me a note on this. Without
ministers, bureaucrats don't even do that. When I was in the finance ministry,
tell you that my stock went up considerably after a few people saw him, coming into the room.
Did you ever have that luck with Mr. Gujral? Did he come in?
No, I was not in the ministry.
But when he came to Egypt, was it? You were in Egypt?
Egypt, yes.
You and
I was ambassador there.
Ambassador. And he made some pretty important statements.
Because he wanted to meet Egyptian intellectuals, which I had organized. And actually, the press was there. And the press asked him some question. At that time, we were having a lot of difficulty with the British. Robin Cook had made certain statements which were very unpalatable. And the Deputy Foreign Secretary of the UK had also made some statements, including in the British Parliament. And the Prime Minister Gujral was evidently unhappy about this. And so when a question was asked, I don't know by whom, he said, well, Britain is a third-rate power. They created the Kashmir problem, and now they're offering us solutions.
Britain is a third-rate power.
And this was one day before Queen Elizabeth was to come here on a state visit.
Right.
So I was very glad he said that, frankly.
No, I thought very glad he said, should have said fourth-rate.
You know. No, I mentioned to you the other day, because after Brexit, it will become a fourth-rate, so he missed it by a numeral.
So just to sum up, a lot of it started with him, the trust factor in the with our neighbors. Then also, to be honest, and Dr. Manmohan Singh is here and you can say it quite openly, India's growth rate just shot up compared to the rest of our neighborhood. We were lagging way behind them in our old rate of growth of 3% and 3.5%. It's now averaging 7.5%, 8%, and ahead of everybody else. That also helps. That's one factor that helps in foreign relations as well, that your country is doing so well. And you
and
have
the bomb.
And the bomb. Here's the man who did the bomb.
Combination.
and the signing of the treaty. Yeah, nuclear treaty. That helped?
Oh, yes. Well, let me say that the fact that India's economic trajectory saw such a dramatic change, that expanded our diplomatic options. There is no doubt about that. It created more space for us. And I certainly feel that maybe the nuclear deal may not have been possible if we did not have that trajectory. If India was not being seen as this new emerging power, a very, very dynamic economy, the general sort of discourse was of India being the next China.
Yes.
I think that certainly created a great deal of,
So the slowdown, does it worry you now in terms of our foreign relations? Not
yeah, well, hopefully it will not be
it's
an extended slowdown. But I don't think we should underestimate the importance of economic performance in terms of our diplomatic options.
So overall, just to summarize, the position now in India versus the rest of the world, and especially our neighbors, compared to when Mr. Gujral was there? And how would he have dealt with it today, do you think?
I think, you have to respond to circumstances as they develop.
Yes.
So you can't say that what was valid 25 years ago
very different
would be applicable today.
But the fundamentals of humility and asking people and getting diverse opinions that he would have...
That is entirely... and decision making, which is quite separate from how we deal with our neighbors. I think what we are missing in all this is that we put the entire burden on our shoulders to improve relations with neighbors. And we don't pay enough attention as to why the neighbors actually make things difficult for us. There are a variety of reasons they do this. Of course, bringing in external power, as was mentioned earlier, to balance India, there are identity issues.
So it's not all our fault, is what?
Certainly not.
Right.
I've served in Nepal, and
well,
he has served in Nepal.
He
served in Nepal, I can tell you. All this talk about we trying to be big brothers in Nepal or push them into certain... It's not true at all. They have resisted water resources cooperation with us for years and years and years. I can actually, if you have a few moments, I'll tell you something.
Yeah.
I had taken over at Nepal. I was Shadid Affairs. Ambassador had not been appointed. Nepal had huge floods. They wanted rice and wheat. So Prime Minister of Nepal, Suryabhai Thapa, called me and made the request for, I forget what they figure, 100,000 tons of wheat, 10,000 tons of rice. I spoke to, I sent a telegram to Mr. Ascotra. He was Foreign Secretary. Mind you, within 48 hours, he rang me and said, you go and tell him that this is done. You tell us where we will hand over these things to you. So I was very happy. I went and communicated this to the Prime Minister. Then days passed, nothing happened. Then I spoke to his Principal Secretary, yes, what's happening? I mean, you asked us, we made an offer, and he said, no, we are waiting for the Chinese to make us an offer.
Ah.
So, this is the thing.
Shyam Saran, what are the Chinese doing right that we are not? And just a quick answer to that. Generally, how would Gujral's Aam Aadmi inclusive style of functioning made current foreign policy different?
Firstly, this impression that the Chinese are 10 foot tall and they do everything right in our neighborhood, I think that's false. I mean, Chinese have as much, if not more, frustration in our neighborhood than, you know, we do. But, and our neighbors play both of us. And
I think
so it's,
the economy matters.
Exactly.
In this
but right now they have the economic power and they have, so they use that. But what would Mr. Gujral have done? You know, I think he, one thing about him that we haven't mentioned so far, he always tried to anticipate what was coming. He was the first Indian MP to actually, since Pilu Modi, I remember, in the late 60s, early 70s, to go to Taiwan in 1992, for instance,
Taiwan.
As a serving MP.
Indian MP.
He was. And
ahead of his time.
When we were negotiating the opening of an office, we wanted to test the waters, and this was under the Narasimha Rao government, and he was more than willing to. He came to Israel before he was foreign minister the second time. I remember as an MP went and saw Yasser Arafat and so on. When he became foreign minister, we actually invited the Israeli president, Weizmann, here in December 1996, which was, in those days, I mean, that was a pretty courageous thing to do. And especially with...
Quietly courageous.
It's not a good thing to say to a politician that you're a brave man, but he was. Because
you said you were a brave man, and he wondered why.
I made the mistake of saying it to him once, actually, at the end of this visit, this Weizmann visit. And he immediately asked me, what is wrong? and then I realized this is not the right phrase, you know, to use with politicians. But the fact is nothing had gone wrong. But it did take courage to do something. But so what I think he'd have done now is actually tried and anticipate where we're going in the neighborhood and to see what he could do to actually make sure that our relationship with all these other smaller neighbors is much better.
And scholarly ability to do that.
And I think he could have done that. But, you know, I don't think the neighborhood is lost or anything, not at all. In fact, we have huge strengths in the neighborhood, but we must accept that it's never going to be an exclusive neighborhood. Right. South Asia is no longer a backwater in the world. Therefore, the outside world, outside powers, are going to be interested in this region. So you'll have to up your game. And I think we're more than capable of doing that.
Right. Final word with you, Shyam Saran.
I certainly believe that we have all the assets, tangible as well as intangible
and
assets.
How would Mr. Gujral have handled it differently now?
Well, you know, I think it is unfair to put Mr. Gujral in a situation today which
it's
is... I think enough has been said about the manner in which he would have approached issues, which is to anticipate how things may develop, looking at, you know, perhaps crafting a policy after consulting a very large number of people, you know, being somewhat creative about the manner in which you handle issues. So I think in terms of what we have said, neighborhood first policy, that would very much be in line with what Mr. Gujral would have done.
But the manner in which...
Soft exterior, he was pretty tough. On the CTBT, he was very firm. If you read his interview...
Yeah, on the emergency, he was very...
Well, that is an internal matter. I'm talking foreign policy. On CTBT, he was very tough. He said, we must preserve our nuclear option.
Yeah.
We are not going to get isolated. The world needs India.
And that
what has been negotiated is not a treaty, but a charade. I mean, he used very strong words.
Really?
And with regard to the overture to Pakistan... Yes, the foreign secretary levels talk took place, and this was the seeds of the composite dialogue was sown. But the Pakistanis insisted on having a separate agenda item on Kashmir, which he refused. Consequently, there was no composite dialogue. It was resumed later.
So the final analysis, would you describe him as a politician who was humble, scholarly, intelligent, and tough, and that you don't get them like that anymore?
I think you're right. You described it very well.
I think you're right in the first part. I hope we get them again.
I'm sure we'll get them.
We'll get them again. Optimist. Thank you all very much for joining us. A round of applause. Thank you.
क्या आपको पता है कि इंडिया को डायबिटीज यानी मधुमेह का कैपिटल कहा जाता है? पर डायबिटीज का मरीज सिर्फ डायबिटीज का शिकार नहीं होता है, बल्कि उसका सीधा असर उसके इम्यूनिटी पर भी पड़ता है, मतलब बीमारियां होने का खतरा भी ज्यादा होता है। इसीलिए डाबर च्यवनप्रकाश जो है एक साइंटिफिकली टेस्टेड इम्यूनिटी बूस्टर, वो भी बिना शुगर के। डाबर च्यवनप्रकाश।